You're listening to Master Coach Mindset with Rhonda Britten, Season 4, Episode 3, brought to you by the Fearless Living Institute. Welcome to Master Coach Mindset, a masterclass in the art of coaching. Hi, my name is Rhonda Britten, and I'm an Emmy Award winner, four-time best-selling author, and a master life coach since 1995. Each week, I'll be sharing tips, tools, and techniques that will up-level your skills, increase your confidence, turning you into a master coach. Welcome to Season 4 of Master Coach Mindset. Hi, my name is Rhonda Britten, and this season, I'm going to be opening up my archives and sharing the most popular questions I've received over the last two decades from coaches just like you. Whether it's about the art of coaching or addressing your clients' questions about relationships, career, or self. Plus, I will be answering the questions you have right now about your practice and your clients. So go ahead and ask me anything at mastercoachmindset.com. That's right. Go visit mastercoachmindset.com and click on Ask Rhonda Anything and go ahead and ask. In today's episode, I'll be sharing my answers to your questions straight from my archives. The topic today, the art of coaching.
Terry, how can I support you? Oh, okay. this is Rhonda, I take it.
Yes, it is.
I saw you a couple years ago at Navo, and I forget what city, and I absolutely adore you.
Oh, thank you.
I've got three questions.
Yes.
I am an executive coach, and when I talk to people, my tagline is, who do you vent to? Who do you tell your problems to?
Mm-hmm.
That type of thing. I don't know what else to say, and I don't know how I can close the sale.
Mm-hmm. Well, first of all, are you talking about corporations as executive coaches? Are you working with VPs? Who's paying you? Is it the individual or the corporation?
In most cases, it would be the same. I'm targeting women business owners.
Okay. So they have, if it's women business owners, you know, under $1 million a year?
Yes.
Okay. So at the time, who do you vent to is not necessarily enough. It's not a solution oriented.
Okay.
It doesn't make me feel like you're going to also help me solve my problems, which I am uncomfortable talking to about anybody else because none of my friends understand.
Okay.
Okay. So it's almost as if what I'm hearing is what you want to do is be the person that, you know, kind of, I'm going to go roundabout and get to the end eventually, but it's like you're going to go roundabout and say, okay, depending on what they say, is that you're going to be the person to support them in taking that leadership position and maximize it to the full potential while supporting their humanity.
Okay.
So it's more of a look. I can, you know, I need somebody to talk to. I mean, that's the problem I have. I mean, there's so few people that understand where I am, okay?
Mm-hmm.
And it is epidemic for CEOs. CEOs, people that own their own businesses, have few places. So your service is needed is what I'm getting at.
Mm-hmm.
And what I want to do is if I invest my money, I don't need to vent. I need solutions.
Okay.
Now, you and I both know they're going to vent, yet that's not what they're willing to pay for. Especially if they're women business owners, they're on tight budgets because they're trying to build their business.
Mm-hmm.
So it really has to come from a place of that you can help build their business while supporting them, you know, as being human or whatever, however you would word that in your own personal way.
Mm-hmm.
Does that make sense?
Yes, it does.
Because if I have so little money, I mean, I'm your client right now. You know, I'm your client. I'm a women business owner. You know, I make good money, but not, you know, not a millionaire. And you know, got some money, I could use a coach. But venting isn't enough for me. I want to make sure you're going to increase my business if I'm going to use you. You and I both know that business will increase if they have somebody to discuss things with.
Okay.
So for that, for you more than anyone, you would be focused on results per se, while other coaches might be focused when they're pitching or speaking to somebody on the process.
Okay.
Because they're so tight, they're tight on time, they're tight on money, they're trying to build. It's all about focusing on, because that mindset is all about how can I become more profitable, how can I be better.
Okay. Wow, just when I look at it, this is great.
Does that make sense to you?
It makes a lot of sense.
And I would invite you to not, you know, to eliminate the thinking of closing the sale.
Okay.
Because that just gets into sales mentality and people that are at the executive coach level like yourself and people that are doing, you know, that I'm going to go to like you for this particular job,
mm-hmm.
It's a very intimate relationship.
Okay.
You know, I'm going to tell you about my business. I'm going to tell you about the money I'm making and not making. I'm going to tell you how my relationships suck, you know?
Mm-hmm.
It's very intimate. So any sales mentality is going to make me think that I'm part of a mass project. And if it's my business, it's my baby, and it has to feel very intimate. It has to feel like they're it, you know, like they're the only ones.
Mm-hmm.
Because then I feel like you're going to give me the time and the attention. And, of course, I would focus on why focus on women business. Obviously, I'm going to think you will have a business of your own or have done that or have experience with that.
Mm-hmm.
So that I can use that. So something very important is, you know, if you've had any major accomplishments in your life, you know, whether you've had a company of 1.5 million or built a section of a corporation into 20 million or, you know, anything of that sort, that's something that you can have the tip of the tongue to support them and that you do know how to do this.
Okay. So I should not be aggressive in I don't want to say pursuing them.
No, absolutely not.
Asking them, just keep it low-key and let them make the first move to hire me, to come to me.
You know, this is it's kind of like a dance. Are you networking to get most of your clients at this point?
Yes, I am.
Okay. And you belong to networking organizations?
That I do, yes.
Okay, great. And because I would think that would be a very fruitful place for you. The thing with networking organizations, everybody wants everybody to buy from them.
Mm-hmm.
So your opportunity when you go and you pitch yourself, so to speak, you know, have your 30 seconds, you're all about results. You know, when you give your pitch, it's not like, I'm here to let you vent and to support you. You know, because in their mind right now, it's their mother or their best friend that can do that. Now, you and I both know that's not necessarily true, the way you're going to do it, but that's what they think.
Okay.
So when you're talking about yourself in those 30-second or 10-second meeting, you know, those 10-second moments that you have, those 30 seconds, it really is about, I just want to tell you a story about a client of mine. You know, she went from, you know, 500, you know, half a million in sales to a million in sales in 6 months based on our work together. And that's what I can do for you.
Good.
So that's going to make me take up a notice. If you're not going to go for numbers, you can say, I had a woman business owner that was frazzled, had 3 kids, feeling very pressured, unable to complete, feel good about herself in work and at her home. And within 3 months of working together, not only is she personally satisfied and having extraordinary results at work, but she's also having more love in her family, because that's what I do. So whatever you really focus on, and again, I do agree that, yes, they're going to come to you. You have to make yourself available.
Mm-hmm.
And I would definitely probably, if there's an opportunity, you know, go to coffee or lunch. But definitely I would wait for them to come to you, because if you go after them, they're not necessarily going to be as committed because they don't think they need you.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
So you can make it easy by giving the first session, you know, as a, you know, 30 minutes or 40 minutes, whatever you do.
Mm-hmm.
You know, make sure that maybe that's on your business card or on your flyer or on your handout or whatever your opportunities for marketing are. Say, you know, let me help you master business and family or whatever your expertise is.
Mm-hmm.
And, to support you in knowing what I do and seeing if we're a good match, 30-minute free session or 45 or an hour. So it's about not like, see if I'm for you. No, it's like, see if we're a good match, because that's, again, a more powerful stance.
Okay.
My attitude, and this is how I train my coaches, they definitely never call a client.
Okay.
That's my philosophy. Do you return a call? Of course. If somebody says, please call me, I always go, you know what? Here's my number. You call me when you're ready. I don't say, okay. I go, okay, you know what? What would really support our relationship is I'm going to give you my number. Here it is. And you call me whenever you're ready to have an intro talk or a free session or however you want to frame it. I say that right up front. People say that to me all the time. Oh, Rhonda, would you call me? No, I'm not going to call me. I'm not going to call them. I'm not. Because then that puts me in the position of that I'm going to babysit.
Mm-hmm.
And I want to go right away in the relationship very, very powerfully.
Mm-hmm.
And so it's accountability, because that's what you're about, Sherry. That's what you're about. So it's accountability. So immediately you have to put it into their hands and say, I look forward to your call, and I cannot wait to support you in this. We are going to do magic together, or however you want to phrase it.
Okay.
And then you hand them the card and smile whenever you see them. And you can go up to them if you're at a networking meeting and see them. How is things going? you know, just as you would just anybody. But never mentioning your business unless you're in a relationship where it's, you know, where it's kind of like a joke of the day. Oh, okay, I'm going to hire you someday, sure, just not yet. Okay, well, whenever you're ready.
Okay.
Does that make sense?
It does.
How many clients do you have right now?
I've got about 3.
Okay, and do you want to do this full time?
Yes.
Okay, and how many clients are you going for?
I'd like to have, well, full time, yes, but I'm doing other things. I'd like to have, I guess, about 10 or 15.
Okay, great.
Which would be pretty much all that I could handle.
Great. Well, there's no reason why you can't do that within the next 3 months.
Okay. Because I'm a certified Women Business Enterprise, and I was just at a networking luncheon, so to speak, and I've got follow-up to do this weekend.
Mm-hmm.
I typically just drop people a note. It's nice to see you, blah, nice to meet you, blah, blah, blah.
Mm-hmm.
So I'll incorporate some of this stuff.
Yes.
Okay. Along those lines, I'm also a motivational speaker.
Mm-hmm.
And I know I am very good at what I do.
Mm-hmm.
How do I set myself apart from the other people to get the speaking jobs? Yeah, the Rotaries, all the women's organizations you have to speak to kind of get your way up.
Well, there should be, what area do you live in? Midwest, South, East?
I'm in Texas.
Okay. There are so many organizations, Lion Club, Rotary, Chambers, that need speakers. Do not hesitate to get a booking 6-8 months in advance.
Okay.
You know, just start collecting them. Because bottom line is, if you speak to one Rotary, you're going to speak to them all. If you speak to one Chamber, you're going to speak to them all. If you don't, you're not that good.
Okay.
Because I've done this. I spoke for free for 2 years.
Mm-hmm.
And literally probably spoke to every Chamber of Commerce in Southern California, every Rotary Club, every Lions Club. Because what they do is they literally go, oh, well, you should talk to this Rotary Club because they share speakers. You know, they definitely share speakers. Do you have a flyer or a handout or, you know, a brochure of some sort that talks about what you do?
What I speak on? Yes.
Yes.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. First of all, what I would really invite you to do is eliminate the word motivational speaker.
Okay.
This is just me, Rhonda Britton's, for, you know, feelings. Motivational speaker is definitely overused,
mm-hmm.
and it puts you in the category of rah, rah, rah.
Mm-hmm.
Now, maybe you are rah, rah, rah. I'm not sure. You know, I'm not rah, rah, rah.
Mm-hmm.
I'm very content-driven.
Mm-hmm.
And, yeah, you're going to be motivated and inspired after you hear me. But the word motivation, for some people, has a very negative connotation.
Mm-hmm.
So what I would invite you to do, are you willing to share with me your topic title?
See, I've got a number of them.
Okay. And you have one main one.
It's probably...
And you don't have to say it because this is going to be... This is taped, so just feel... Whether you feel comfortable or not.
Yes, I do. It's smashing through obstacles, going after what you want. I'm a black belt in Taekwondo.
Oh, great, great. And do you have a picture of you doing Taekwondo on your handout?
Not on all my handouts. It's on my website.
It's on your website.
Mm-hmm.
Do you have it on, you know, whatever you hand out? You know, whenever you meet somebody, is it on your business card?
No.
I'm just wondering, and again, this is just our first conversation, just so this is just me going off the cuff.
Mm-hmm.
I'm almost wondering if that's how you set yourself apart.
Okay.
And it's kind of corny. You know, it's on the cornier side. But it's also something that you use. Do you use metaphors in your talk about Taekwondo?
Yes.
Well, it just seems to me that I know very few speakers that are experts at Taekwondo, and it seems a very powerful vision of a woman, you know, taking a very powerful stance and saying, you know, not, you know, kind of coming from the frame of mind where I know how to do this because I've done it, not only in my personal life, not only in business life, but also with my physical life, because I can do this.
Mm-hmm.
It's kind of like you're one of the boys.
Mm-hmm.
Like you can pay, you're one of the boys. You can do that physical stuff.
But do I need to turn it around so that put up more of a focus towards them instead of saying, you know, I did this and I did that, like especially the title?
Oh, absolutely. I mean, smashing through walls. You know, what is the result that what is it that they want? You know, what is smashing through walls? Maybe your title is No Obstacles or Obstacle Free or, you know, it's kind of like you have to go for what you specifically do. You know, my first title was, you know, Are You Waiting for a Miracle? Because people would go like, yeah, I am. guy up. Well, great, because I'm here to have you alter that and actually achieve your miracles rather than just waiting for one. And then, of course, that mutated into fearless living.
Okay.
So, you know, don't hesitate to change your titles of your talks as you embody them more and get more insight. Don't hold on to them. And how many topics do you have?
Oh, I probably have about 8.
Okay, too many.
Okay.
People don't know what to do.
Okay, how many should I cut it down to?
I would get it down to 3.
Okay.
And I would have one emphasized and the other two in, you know, one emphasized and the other two in minor text. Because unless you're an established speaker, they don't know what to do then. They're confused.
Okay.
Well, which topic should I have? Which one's her best? What should I do?
Okay.
You know, you can have a main topic, and if you want to have the two sub ones, and then say, you know, individual and, you know, personalized, you know, I personalized speeches, and or if there's something, you know, and more topics are available depending on your needs or something to that effect.
Okay, so I shouldn't try to be all things to all people.
Oh, gosh, no. You are definitely going to be a generalist then, and you are going to be considered a dime a dozen. You must separate yourself. And I think that's the first question you asked me.
Yes.
How can you differentiate yourself?
Okay.
Well, Taekwondo will differentiate yourself to differentiate right then and there. And so cutting down your topics that are very, very specific, is going to support you in getting more business, and it'll start branding you. If you're everything to everyone, there's no branding. You're not branded.
Okay.
You have to come up with a way to brand yourself. And so whether it's the image of you in your Taekwondo outfit doing something, or whether it's some sort of something in that frame of mind, that reference, you know, referencing that, that's going to set you apart. Then you're going to become, oh, that chick that does karate. You know, they're not going to necessarily know Taekwondo, but they're like, that chick that does that thing. Let's get her.
Okay.
Does that make sense?
Yeah, it does.
Okay, great. Well, our time is up, Sherry. Are you complete?
Yes.
Okay. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Rhonda.
How can I support you today?
Well, Rhonda, I have a new client coming that I'm working with now,
mm-hmm.
and the area that she wants me to help her with is at the beginning of the year she became involved in a network marketing program.
Great.
And my wheel of fear started coming up because of that,
mm-hmm.
and you know, and I know I can support her in it, but my wheel of fear came up because in years past I had tried to work in network marketing and was not very successful at
mm-hmm.
it. And, you know, I talked to her, I had a free session with her last night, and I gave her exercises and homework to do to help her, support her, and move her through it.
Yes.
But, you know, the challenges that I'm having is that in future sessions is, you know, I see my fear starting to come up, and how successful as a coach can I be? My fear comes up, and then I keep running back as, you know, well, I never did very well at that, but how can I support her in doing that?
Yes. Well, you said it brilliantly, and I'll just say the word that you didn't use yet is called judgment. So you're having a judgment against yourself, and therefore you didn't do very good. Maybe you had positive, negative experiences. No matter what, you weren't successful. And therefore, if you're not successful at something, you can't help other people. So that's a judgment. And now, have you ever heard what we can't teach, what we can't do, we teach?
Yes.
Okay, great. So many times we, on a reality-based level in our own lives, maybe not successful doing what we're practicing sometimes, but the bottom line, it doesn't mean we still don't have the skill in order to help somebody else. So your opportunity is going, you could actually speak the truth and say, wow, I am so fortunate to be able to coach you on this, because this is something that's very dear and near to my heart, and I'm just so excited about it. Now, she doesn't have to know that you're, you know, going to be healed by this by working with her, but it's something that you can say, well, this is so exciting. I'm so looking forward to supporting you, because in your mind and in your life, you're actually going to learn how to better support yourself by supporting her, by removing your judgment.
Okay.
Does that make sense?
Absolutely.
So what your opportunity is okay. It's not whether you were successful or not. It's like, do you know how to coach?
Yes.
And do you have skills now that you didn't have those years ago?
Absolutely.
Great. And so if you have those skill base, and if you lean on your skills and those tools you have, those skills and tools are going to support you in the areas where fear comes up for you.
Okay.
Does that make sense?
Absolutely. Thank you.
Is there anything else that I can support you with? Are you complete?
I'm complete, Rhonda.
Okay, great. Thank you.
You're the greatest coach in the world.
Thank you.
serve you, Geraldine?
Well, I have a client that is pretty much stuck in her story.
Mm-hmm.
And I've tried various things. She went through a pretty traumatic job release earlier this year, just a couple months ago, where she walked away from a very abusive job situation, hasn't been able to find another job.
Mm-hmm.
So she's really in fear about that and wants to keep going back to, but I had to leave this job, and telling me why. And
okay, so stop. Okay. What I invite you to do is a couple things. One is, when she starts telling you a story, do you ask her what she learned from the job?
I have asked her that, and we get, you know, she'll go forward and then she always goes back.
Okay. So what I invite you to do every time she goes back, you have to correct her and go, excuse me, I'm sorry. I just wanted to know 10 things that you really learned from this job. Then what I do in these types of situations, I say, do you want your past job to control you or do you want to control your future jobs? And she says, well, I want to control my future jobs. Great. Then let's use your past experience as a, you know, playground for you to learn new communication skills. Because do you think it's communication skills that kept you in this abusive relationship at work? Well, yes, it is. I mean, that's the only thing she doesn't know how to do. She doesn't know how to put boundaries in place. She doesn't know how to communicate. And so I would use those examples as teaching her how to do it.
Okay.
And then if she says, well, but the person, okay, are you going to allow a person to run your life, or are you going to choose to run your life? It's your choice. You can do either one you want. And don't give any credence to the abusive relationship. You can go, got it, but don't go, oh, wow, you're really brave to go through that. Oh, it's not brave to go through an emotionally abusive relationship. It's basically people go through emotionally abusive relationships because they don't have the skills to get out or the confidence to get out. So it's yes, congratulations that you made it through. Absolutely, we can say congratulations for that. And then it's, do you want to make a new choice, or do you want to keep using this story to keep you stuck? It's your choice.
Mm-hmm. Okay, so I say that to her, just giving an example, and she gets angry and reacts.
Great. And so what's anger about?
Okay. That would be the next question.
So she gets angry. Okay, so wow, where'd this come from? You know, what's this anger about? Well, I can't believe that you think that I caused the emotional abusive relationship. Hey, I didn't say that. I said that, why did you think you stayed? If you knew it was emotionally abusive, why did you stay? Because it was the only job. So it's the only job in the entire city where you work that you could do? Well, yeah, it's the one I had, and it's hard to find another job. And are you making that up, or is that a fact? Well, I'm trying to find one now, and it's hard. And why do you think it's hard now? Well, because I just came from this awful relationship. Yes. And so is this past job choosing your future for you? So I'm going to ask you again, is your past job choosing your future for you? And until we heal the past, do you think you're going to have the confidence? Do you have the confidence to get a new job? Well, no, I'm really, hurt from the past relationship. Great. Congratulations that you know that. And again, do you want that to run your life? Do you want that to choose your future?
Good.
It's all about not giving her the sympathy for going through this horrible thing. It's about understanding that she went through this horrible thing and supporting her in the realization that the only reason she went through this horrible thing is because of lack of confidence, lack of skills. I mean, she's not the only one to go through an emotionally work relationship and or emotional in relationship period, whether it's work or home. So it doesn't make people bad people. It's just lack of skills. I mean, I went through one, and it was my lack of confidence and my lack of willing to be rejected. And so that's the thing. We must train her, support her in learning so that the next job doesn't seem scary. The next job is she's actually excited to practice these new skills.
Okay. So I'm hearing there's a fine line between, well, maybe not even a fine line, but that line that we don't cross between sympathy and understanding.
Yes.
We want to help guide them into what were the gifts that came from this relationship.
Yes.
Situation, and how can you use that to better your future?
Yes.
Okay.
And give me a typical situation that keeps going over and over your mind. So you keep bringing up this past relationship at work that was abusive. Great. So just tell me one of the typical things. Great. Let's figure out how to do it the next time if that happened to you.
Okay.
So if she keeps bringing up something or she keeps going back to it, go, okay, I want you to pick one of the things that always happen, a typical thing. Well, you know, he always called me stupid. Great. That's perfect. Well, it didn't feel good. Oh, I know, but do you want people to call you stupid from now on? No. Great. So let's practice what you could do if somebody called you stupid in the future.
Good.
So if I called you stupid, what are some things you could say to me? Well, I don't know. I freeze. Great. Congratulations. At least you know you freeze. Now let's memorize something, because when you freeze, you forget everything. So let's memorize something just until you start building your confidence. And maybe something you could say is, it's not acceptable to call me a name.
Mm-hmm.
Now, if this person says, I'm not stupid, then they're reacting, and the other person would be like, yes, you are. Mm-hmm. It's not about whether she's stupid or not. It's not about the truth of stupid or not. Mm-hmm. It's about, that's not acceptable.
Okay. Drawing a boundary.
Absolutely. And I'm sure that's where she has a difficult time in other areas of her life. So then you say, great, are there other people? Let's put the job aside. And is there any other relationships in your life right now where you feel that you could be taking on more than you need to? Mm-hmm. Is there a place where maybe you're feeling like you put somebody else first, or maybe you're feeling like a doormat, or you're feeling frustrated, or...
Mm-hmm. And absolutely, she would say yes to that, because she talked about her job and her friends.
Great.
Yeah.
So, isn't it funny? I find it interesting that you have the same complaint about your job and your friends. What does that say?
Mm-hmm. She's the common denominator.
Exactly.
Okay.
And so, do you want to keep your friends?
Well, I don't know.
Well, yes, I want to keep my friends. Great. Do you want to keep the friends the way they are right now? Do you want to keep the relationship exactly the way it is now? Well, no. Great. So what do you want the relationship to be like? Well, I want it to be that I can talk to them, and I want it to be like this, and I want it to be like that. Mm-hmm. Great. Are you willing to put the skills in action in order to have that? And are you willing to actually change friends if that need be?
Mm-hmm. Okay. We've been brainstorming ways for her to go out and meet new people.
Mm-hmm. Yes, but meeting new people is not going to help her until she solves the problem with her friends.
Good point.
So it's simultaneous. You're always working on two levels. One is the present, and one is, moving her towards the future, and one is the present. So the present is, if she doesn't like the friend she has now or has trouble with her friends now, then how is she going to have a different relationship with future friends if she doesn't learn the skills now?
Mm-hmm.
So using the friend she has now to learn the skills, have her come back with a situation every week, coach her on it, a new way to communicate, boundaries in place, listen to whether she gets angry or defensive, what are her fear responses?
Yeah, defensive, definitely.
Great. And so I would ask her how easy it is to be a friend with somebody who's defensive all the time.
That's good.
And then at the same time, you're going to look for new friends.
Mm-hmm.
But both have to happen. Otherwise, her next friends are going to be exactly like her new friends. Her old job is going to be exactly like her new job. So you use what is as examples to learn new skills, and then you move them forward.
Okay.
Got it?
Mm-hmm. I do. This is great.
Great. Good work.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Oh, have a great day.
Thank you.
Bye.
How can I support you today?
Well, Rhonda, I want to know if you have a master plan or if you're just making up...
That's such a great question, because I basically make it up as I go. And yes, do I have things that I see in my future, maybe my own television show, get on the radio, to have my own radio show again, which I love doing. Obviously I'm writing my third book. There are things that are in the process. Sure, do I want to do corporate? But bottom line is I really allow the process to take hold of me rather than controlling the process. So that means I'm free to create. That means I'm free to listen. That means I'm free to be flexible in how I coach and what my coaching practice is. Because bottom line is, when I began my coaching practice, I thought I was going to work one-on-one. If you would have said to me, in 8 years, you're going to be writing books and speaking to crowds, I would have been like, what are you nuts? I'm a coach. I'm a one-on-one coach. That's what I do. That's all I do. I had no vision of seminars. I have no vision of speaking, no vision of books or TV or radio, none of that. So because I fully committed to the one-on-one coaching, an opportunity for seminars came up. And with reluctance, I eventually did it. And I learned, wow, I love this. And I started doing seminars and really just started taking them on and did the one-on-ones. And from doing my seminars, I thought to myself, gee, I should start speaking to clubs because they'll come to my seminars. And that's how I started speaking. Again, no other reason than to build my existing practice. No big plan of, I'm going to be the best speaker in the whole world. You know, I was just doing the next step. So it's about really being present in the moment and being willing to stay true to your intention, yet being flexible inside that intention so that you can move where it's clear you're getting opportunities so you can take them.
Great.
Does that support you?
Yes, it does.
Great. Are you complete?
Yes, I am.
Great. Thank you.
Thank you.
How can I support you?
The question is, when a client brings up an issue that they're dealing with, and it happens to be an intense issue for you that you're currently dealing with,
yes,
how do you support yourself during the call to make sure that you can support your client and, you know, not get triggered yourself?
Yeah. Well, let's get over the fallacy that you won't get triggered, because you might get triggered. And so, great, so you're triggered. It's always an opportunity when you're triggered. Can you still support your client? Absolutely. Do you still know what you know? Absolutely. Are you going to give the greatest coaching in the world? Maybe. Maybe you'll give the best coach in the world. Another way to deal with it is to actually say, wow, you know what, that's so funny, this is happening exactly to me. Let me tell you what I'm going through. And you actually include yourself in the conversation. Now, I only invite you to do that if you've actually healed yourself or actually at the other end of it. You know, I don't want you to talk about something that you're actually actively in the, you know, the middle of, you know, the hell with. Only if you've, you know, if you've moved through it. So let's say you're in the middle of, you know, hell in something, and they just go, you know, maybe your boyfriend just broke up with you, and they say, oh, my boyfriend just broke up with me, and, you know, the jerk, and you think your boyfriend's a jerk, and yes, and so you get to actually coach. What a great gift is that you get to coach yourself using this other person. You get to tell them everything that is the truth, that you know is the truth somewhere inside of you, in order to support your own healing. So obviously, if you're in the middle of stuff, you can automatically, there's certain things you can count on. You can automatically go to gratitude. You can automatically go to acknowledgments. You can automatically say, well, is this empowering you or disempowering? You can automatically go to some skills that you can count on. Go to expectation. And you can just move on to a topic that you know that you know that you can count on yourself. And any topic, you know, let's say it's the boyfriend. Right there, you can talk about expectation. You can talk about excuses. You can talk about complaint. I mean, you can talk about anything. So just go into an area where you feel most comfortable. That's another way to deal with it. And then the last way is to really allow yourself to be in the midst of your own pain and be present to somebody else. And that's a great skill to learn. It's a wonderful skill to learn. And then in that moment, you're detached. You get detached from your own personal pain and learn how to transcend it in that moment. And that's a great gift that our clients give us, that we actually get to learn how to do that with their support. And they don't even know they're doing it.
Yeah.
Does that support you, or is there something you want more? Because I get a sense that you want something else?
No, I think it does.
Okay.
And I see what you're saying.
Yeah. What am I saying?
When it comes up, to go somewhere where you're going to be able to support them. So bring up things, even though it's a situation that you may feel similar pain in, go to, well, what can you be grateful for? What can
yes.
you allow yourself for in this situation? Those
yes.
kinds of things.
Yes.
And in turn, that's supporting you to in thinking, yeah, I can be grateful for that too.
Yes. And also, it's also a matter of now you get to trust if you're really a good coach. You know, bottom line is, my life may be upside down, and I might be going through a personal, challenging time, and you might bring up a situation for me as a client, but bottom line is I have learned to trust that no matter what's going on in my personal life, I can be present with you and coach you. So even though it's present, even though I can taste it, it's present for me, I can still stay present with you in your pain. And yes, I can be, you know, mine's here, mine's with me, but it doesn't consume me. And it doesn't decide that moment that it's going to get more attention than the person in front of you. So again, it's another opportunity to practice being present. Can you be fully present with your client and be in the midst of your own pain? And the answer is yes. And that's something that you can practice, learn to do, and then trust that you do it even when you feel like, wow, that was a horrible session. I was totally in my stuff. You know what? Bottom line is those sessions, your client will go, wow, I just love that session. It was so great because you were really right there with them.
Mm-hmm.
Does that make sense?
Yes, a lot of sense.
Okay. You're welcome.
Are you serious about becoming a master coach? Do you want to learn the 8 coaching skills that I teach my own certified Fearless Living coaches? Until now, these 8 coaching skills were reserved for students in my Life Coach certification program. But now, I'm going to teach them to you. Join me at my 3-day live event, Fearless Conversations Workshop for Coaches Only. If you're ready to get serious about becoming a 7-figure master coach, go to mastercoachmindset.com to learn more. And be sure to save your seat today. Seating is limited, so grab your seat at mastercoachmindset.com. This has been an episode of Master Coach Mindset, brought to you by the Fearless Living Institute. If you know someone who could benefit from today's episode, please share it with them. I know they'll be grateful. Until next time, be fearless.